So this 42-year-old male who was in on case of seizure disorder since June 2015. He was on treatment with carbamazepine, and symptoms started in this patient 4 years ago when he had dry cough, Raynaud's phenomena, and polyarthritis. ANA was positive, even RNP was also positive. Diagnosis was made as NCTD, and he was started on azathioprine followed by MMF along with steroid and HCQS. In October 2016, he had bilateral pleural effusion. Then the examination shows exudative with raised ADA. He was started on APT, which was given for 10 months on. Without any improvement, CT showed there was no improvement in the effusion. Patient had developed NSRCA with proteinuria in November 2017. This time, kidney biopsy was done. It was showing lupus nephritis class 3 and 5. ELNT protocol was given with cyclophosphamide, and he had no response with that, as there was no response in the proteinuria. Tacrolimus was added with nephrologist consultation. In April 2019, he consulted another rheumatologist with neuroendocrine disease and treated with rituximab. 500 mg weekly doses were given in this patient, along with steroid, and maintenance dose was given with azathioprine. Still, the proteinuria persisted. Reinduction was advised with cyclophosphamide, this time according to NIH protocol, and first dose was given on 5th November of 2019. 5 days later, he had high-grade fever, cough with expectoration, bilateral chest pain, shortness of breath, and worsening NSRCA. Admitted outside, diagnosed as pneumonitis, treated with higher antibiotic including meropenem and tetracycline tazobactam. Blood transfusion was given to unit in view of low hemoglobin. Albumin was infused in view of low serum albumin. These were the imaging from outside at the time of admission and after 10 days of the antibiotic course. There, as you can see, there is no much improvement in the imaging. So he came to AIIMS for the further evaluation. He had admitted with the complaint of oral ulceration, throat pain, fever, cough with expectoration, chest pain, NSRCA, and Raynaud's phenomena. On examination, he was conscious, oriented, he was febrile, pallor was present, large ulcer at eula was there, no apparent cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy. As you see in this photograph, there was bilateral pitting, pitting edema was there. The respiratory examination was showing bilateral crepitation, vitals were showing the higher side BP. CVS was normal, peritoneum was descended, but there was no free fluid, CNS was normal. Patient was evaluated for the disease activity and underlying infectious activity etiology. So routine investigation shows low hemoglobin along with low protein and albumin, which was because of ongoing persistent proteinuria, and AMP was on higher side. Another one, procalcitonin was little bit higher on side, and other investigation it would be within normal limit. This was a CT repeated at AIIMS, which was showing again the bilateral effusion. The effusion was tapped and it was examined. LDH was so high, ADA was very high, gene expert was negative, glucose was on lower side, protein was still high. If you compare the serum albumin, serum level of protein, and DLC, TLC was on little bit higher side. So, pulmonologist was consulted. He advised that we can keep under observation because he has received adequate antibiotic outside, including tetracycline and tazobactam, and along with the meropenem. So this, in view of the low calcium level, serum calcium level, INR calcium was done. This was normal. INR was normal. USG abdomen, in view of increased ALP level, was done. This was suggestive of normal liver with serum mildly increased renal pathogenicity. Thyroid profile was normal. Throat was taken from the ulcer site, which was showing candida albicans and budding yeast in the KF system. Blood culture, urine culture, and sputum, these were the normal. CRP was on the higher side. In view of low hemoglobin, he was done with stool blood for occult blood, it was positive once, and it was repeated, it was negative. User endoscopy was normal, direct wounds was negative, viral markers were negative. So, and in view of seizure disorder he had previously, EEG was done, which was normal. MRI brain one was done, which was non-specific white matter change. Neurologist advised that we can continue carbamazepine in view of this idiopathic seizure disorder. Abdominal fat part biopsy was done in your ongoing persistent proteinuria to rule out amyloidosis, as there was no response with the therapy. On various therapy was given, still there was proteinuria. So abdominal fat part biopsy was negative for amyloidosis. Lipid profile was showing some triglyceridemia only. Disease activity was done to calculated. There was ENA was showing various antibody positivity, and dsDNA was on higher side. UNRNP was high. C3c4 was low. 24 hour protein has increased from 6 to 9 this time. So there was ongoing proteinuria and ongoing disease activity. So to summarize, this patient has defective lupus nephritis, bilateral exudative minimal fluid effusion, which was pneumonic, and with the outside treatment he has responded. We have not given any antibiotic here. Oral candidiasis, which has been treated with fluconazole, and he has responded with that. And now coming to the raised ALP. So for raised ALP, we have done the investigation for the that the intact PTS was normal, bone scan was normal, ultrasound liver for the liver was normal, fibro scan was normal, GGT was on higher side, which is suggestive that the origin of the GGT ALP was liver only. Viral markers were negative, and total anti-hepatitis B or antibody was raised, and HBV DNA was negative, which was suggestive of some previous infection in the past. MRCP was also normal. So we were nowhere regarding this ALP. The origin was liver, but we are not able to say what is the reason for this raised ALP and GGT. X-ray was done after the treatment, and it was showing that there is much improvement, so infusion was responded. And we have given, in the view of disease activity, we have given cyclophosphamide second dose on 10th of December, 10th of January, sorry, 10th of December. So and then third dose was repeated on 10th of January, and third dose, fourth dose is also repeated on Feb also. So now you can see some improvement in the hemoglobin as well as ALP and GGT also has responded. And this case was challenging in view of refractory lupus nephritis, as every treatment, possible treatment with the lupus nephritis has been tried in this patient, and raised, isolated raised alkaline phosphatase, which was not able to find out. Liver was a source, but there is no literature to suggest that isolated ALP or GGT can be elevated in SLE. So this was the challenge for me, and I have tried possible things to see whether this can be because of disease activity or this can be because of some infection, but nothing to find out in this session. Only biopsy was to be done, but patient did not agree with that. To come to that, lupus nephritis, why to say refractory, because we have to look for that therapy which has been adherence with the therapy can be checked with the microfluidic levels in the renal with the patient if it is taking the MMF, and if a cyclophosphamide is being given which is given in the patient, so there is no role of monitoring with that. But we can see the patient is coming on regular basis. If there is that, then we can do the biopsy and see it can label as a refractory lupus nephritis. And if it is there, you can switch from anionic cyclophosphamide. And if it has been rolled out responded with that, you can consider cyclophosphamide, rituximab, calcineurin inhibitor, then the intravenous cyclophosphamide on the prolonged therapy, and which is also has been tried in this patient. So now we left with some investigation treatment only. So now we thank you.